Welcome to Bright. We're so glad you're here with us this morning. Would you please stand as we begin to worship?
Church. My name is Connie Turner, and I'm coming to you live from my third grade pod here at Bright Elementary. I'm a third grade teacher here, and I've taught for 26 years in and out of the school system. And I'm coming to you today to share with you my deep appreciation for the wonderful hand sanitizing stations that all of your volunteers from the Bright Church put together for us and made possible for us to keep our children healthy. But also you sent a message to us, not just to our students, but to our staff as well, about your strong commitment and connection and partnership to our community. I had one of my third graders ask me, Who made these stations? Did they make them for us just because Mr. Frank knows us? And that was not the case. I explained to this student who's new to our community and our school system that the Bright Church reached out to us with these, that you brought these to us as just as your growing and strong commitment to the elementary schools in our district as well as our community. And that student was perplexed to say the least, but after some explaining, we talked about what's involved in a community, and your light shined through to that student as well as many others. So when we walk by these every day and we're using them and the kids are using them, your hand stations not just touch the hands of the students as they're keeping them well, but you're touching their hearts and their mind as well with what you've done for us. Volunteers, friends there at Bright Church, we appreciate you and love you so much, and we thank you for your strong Christian and your strong commitment to our community and to our school systems. We appreciate the support so much. Have a great week, and God bless you all.
Alright guys, good morning. We are glad you're here to worship with us this morning. I just got a couple quick things for you real quick. If you would, grab the connection card out of the bag you grabbed on the way in. So if you haven't been, or if you just started coming since COVID, we typically used to fill out a connection card every single week just so that we have a record of your attendance. Also, if you guys need prayer or you need some information, that way we can get that to you. So if you would fill those out, and on your way out today, drop them in the offering boxes back in the back. Also, we're getting more and more people here. As you guys can tell, things are filling up. So if you can, in your row, just for the people who are coming a little bit late, if you guys could make some more room, kind of scoot together, scoot to one side, whatever. But if you think you can make some more room, that'd be awesome. Just so we do have some people still coming in. So back to this video. So this generosity project has become huge, a lot bigger than what we expected it to be when we first started. It started out with one teacher in the school who's a member here who said, "Hey, can someone make this?" And I said, "I can make one for you. That's not a problem at all." And it turned into us making almost 80 of these for Bright Elementary, North Dearborn Elementary, and then a couple other teachers in our congregation have asked for them. So it's just become a really big thing. And as you saw Mrs. Turner, when she talked about the kid and the conversation that she had, that's not something that we ever really get to see. But because we're stepping out into the community and doing these things, those conversations are happening more than we even realize. So I just want to ask you guys to partner with me. So for those of you who did just start coming, our generosity project is something we typically do every month. We hadn't been doing because of COVID. But if each person that's in here each Sunday gave $1, okay, just $1 above and beyond your regular giving, we would have more money than we know what to do with for these generosity projects. It's that simple. So the ways you can give is there's yellow envelopes sitting on these boxes out here in the lobby. So you can put money into the boxes, or you can grab an envelope, put it in the offering box. We also just added online, so if you do all your giving online, instead of just doing the general fund, if you change that to generosity project, that goes straight to things like this. Right now, we're sitting around $400 for our $2,000 goal to do these. But we did already deliver them because it was a time-sensitive need. They needed to get those in the schools when they started, so we went ahead and knocked those out quick with a great team of volunteers. But I just want to ask you guys for your continued support and partnership so that we can continue to reach out into our community. If you would, bow your head with me, and we'll pray as we continue our worship. Dear Heavenly Father, I just want to thank you for the opportunities that you give us just to shine your light for others. I just pray that Bright will continue to be a shining light in this community, and that we can continue to change lives of those around us. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
As I was preparing for this song this week, there was a lyric that stood out to me, and I just wanted to talks about how when the storms of life come, how we can hide in a God who never moves, that we have the security of being hidden in Him if we build our foundation on the rock. And so it reminded me in Matthew 7, when Jesus talks about the wise and the foolish builder, and He talks about how the foolish man built his house upon the sand, and when the rains and the winds and the storms came, how his house just crumbled. But the wise man built his house on the rock, and when the rain and the wind and the storms came, that house stood firm and secure. And we know Jesus says that the stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone, and He is that cornerstone. And so I think 2020 has been a year full of storms. I think every single person in this room can say, I've weathered at least one storm in 2020, if not more. And so as I was listening to this song this week, just to have that assurance of when we hold tight to God and we build our foundation on that rock, He actually holds tighter to us than we could ever hold to Him. And so would you guys stand with me and sing the song and proclaim that the rock won't move?
Yeah.
safe place in the midst of life's storms. God, I pray that as we continue through this year of ever-changing circumstances and unusual circumstances, as we weather these storms, God, that we would build our house, build our foundation on you, the rock. God, we thank you for your faithfulness, and we thank you for your protection. It's in your Son's name.
Which is known as Yom Kippur, the Jewish high priest would leave a crowd of people, go into the temple with a lamb, and he would sacrifice that lamb for the sins of all the people. And as soon as that animal was dead, he went outside and said, "Tetelestai, it is finished." The people knew that. So when that sacrifice, that lamb, the Bible teaches us, was temporary and imperfect. But the reality is, when Jesus went to the cross for us, he paid it all. He did it all. In fact, you know, it says in Hebrews chapter 10, the Lord declares, "I will remember the sins and lawlessness no more. Where there is forgiveness of these, there is no longer any offering of sin." This is true because Jesus gave it all. And he did it in a way that the Jewish people would understand. Think about his last words, "Tetelestai, it is finished." Something they were used to hearing. So this means it's not up to us. We can't add anything, complete anything, finalize anything. Jesus did it all. This is a time in our service when we meet around the table. And so if you have your little packet, bag with you, if you want to get out your communion cups, basically, here's the cup if you don't have it. But if you're not a baptized believer, this is a great time to think about what Jesus did for you and just contemplate, what's it going to take, what questions do you have to move from the chair of seeker to the chair of believer. If you are a baptized believer, this is a time you want to peel back this first layer and take the bread. And Jesus told us at the Last Supper that this bread represents his body that was broken for us. And so we'll all take that together. And then if you want to carefully peel back the second layer, this juice represents the wine that Jesus shared with the apostles. And he said, "Drink, for this is the blood that is shed for you." And we know that he did that on the cross. And so we'll all drink that together. Holy Father, we come before you today grateful for an opportunity to serve you. You gave it all. And you showed us how much you love us by dying for us while we were yet sinners. And while we were rejecting you and continue to reject you, you showed us how much you love us. You show us every day how much you love us, Lord. We ask you to help us today to hear Jeff's message, to take it, to challenge ourselves as we leave here today to be followers of you because of what you've done for us on the cross and that you loved us first. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
When my niece was about 4 or 5 years old, she spent the day with my dad, her grandfather, and they had a great time together. And when she came home later that evening, her parents noticed she had developed a unique mannerism. She would walk around and spit. And they didn't understand. They go, "That's not nice. Why are you doing that, Savannah?" She goes, "Dada does it." And she was referring to my dad. She had seen him clear his throat and spit several times throughout the day. And so she wanted to be like him. And so she had picked up the habit and was trying to be the spitting image of her grandfather. So imitation is the highest form of flattery. And the greatest way to demonstrate our love for Christ is to follow in his steps, 1 Peter 2:21. So for the past 4 weeks, we've learned about the journey of four-chair discipleship. A disciple is a follower, a learner, a student. And the 12 apostles spent 3 years shadowing Jesus, the master teacher. They watched him teach, watched him serve, watched him heal, watched him help people. They saw him when he was tired. They saw him when he was hungry, when the crowds were cheering, and when he was under attack. And this original internship for the 12 apostles provided a powerful laboratory for learning that changed the course of human history. This method of changing people, growing them, and then watching them as through him they replicated Christ in another spiritual generation of followers who would carry forward the same process. The first week of our series, we looked at chair one, the chair of the seeker, come and see. The next week, we talked about chair two, the believer who makes that determination when Jesus says, follow me, and is all in on that commitment. Last week, Greg talked about the co-worker becoming a fisher of people. And today we conclude in chair four, the disciple maker, go and bear fruit. Luke 6:40 states, everyone who is fully trained will be like their teacher. And Jesus' ministry agenda was to birth a movement of multiplying disciples. He needed fully equipped disciples who were capable of making disciples who could make other disciples. Imitation is the highest form of flattery. That's the challenge to move into chair four today. So let's begin in Matthew chapter 28, that final chapter of the gospel. Turn to that in your Bible or bring it up on your iPad or your phone now. I want you to see our purpose is to make disciples who will make disciples. When someone is on his or her deathbed, family gather around and lean in close to hear that loved one's final words. And when someone is leaving and you aren't sure you're ever going to see that person again, we pay special attention to the parting instructions. And so that's what Jesus gave us in Matthew 28, these parting instructions. Just before he leaves the earth to return to heaven, Jesus meets with his remaining 11 apostles. Remember, Judas had defected and died. He meets them at a mountain where he had told them to gather. And here we see the process of transforming lives to resemble Christ. Beginning in verse 18. Then Jesus came to them and said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. Christ's last command must be our first concern. To make disciples who will make disciples. Several things stand out to me surrounding the word all in this brief passage. You might underline the phrase in verse 18, all authority. Jesus had the power, unlimited power in heaven. He came to earth. He had authority on earth over the world, over the demons. It was delegated to him from his Father, God. And then in verse 19, underline all nations. And the grammatical construction of this phrase in the original language suggests as you are going, make disciples. As you're going through your day, this is to be an ongoing assignment for us to make disciples. That means as you go to work at your job, as you go to class at your school, as you go to the doctor's office, as you get an oil change, as you shop at Kohl's, as you eat at Los Primos, whatever you do, wherever you go, make disciples. And Jesus makes it clear that this salvation is intended for all people groups, for all ethnicities, for all nations. And that's why BCC actively supports global missions throughout the world, in addition to our outreach to our local community. We want to make it hard to go to hell in Bright, but we also want to make it easier for all nations to go to heaven. So underline all nations. And then the next phrase with all is all things, still in verse 20. It says, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. That's that step of moving into chair two and becoming a believer. And then as we grow as followers in chair three by learning all he has to teach us about himself, all things. The apostles had that opportunity to live, to travel, to spend time with Jesus directly. And in Acts 4:13, people took note that these men had been with Jesus. So today we don't have that same privilege, but we seek to mirror that process by reading the Bible, God's Word, by participating in a life group. And you can get signed up at the end of our service today. Being in an adult Bible fellowship where we study, we do life with some godly mentors who reflect Christ and help challenge us to grow. And next, I want you to underline verse 20, the word always. That really talks about it at all times. And surely I will be with you always until the very end of the age. This was a specific promise made to the 11 apostles, but it has a carryover value to you and to me. Jesus said he was leaving to return to the Father, but that he would send a comforter, a counselor, a companion to abide with us for all times. That is his Holy Spirit promised to reside in us at baptism. Never alone, with us always, at all times. I remember a dear Christian lady in a church where I previously served. Her name was Shirley Benton, and she shared that as a little girl, she took this last verse, verse 20, as a very personal promise and thought it was directed specifically to her. Whenever she heard this verse being read, "Surely I will be with you always," she found it reassuring. I'd like for you to repeat that verse, for us to do that together in a moment. Let's state it aloud again. Only insert your name into that promise, okay? I'll say, "And Jeff, I am with you always to the very end of the age." You say your name. So let's try that together. Speak your name. "And Jeff, I am with you always to the very end of the age." It's a great promise to remember. This process, this progression of making disciples is to get them in and grow them up, to convert and conserve, to evangelize and to edify. It's the Great Commission to make disciples, to go teach, baptize, and teach. Chair one responds to the invitation, come and see, listen in, explore the claims of Christ, ask questions, read up on what it means to move from skeptic to seeker. And then, as we grow and learn, conviction must precede conversion. And we surrender to the Lord by believing, repenting, confessing, and being immersed as we move into chair two as a believer. And remember, just because you live in a garage doesn't make you a car. And just because you attend church doesn't make you a Christian. Even wearing a BCC wristband won't qualify you as a committed follower of Christ. Are you growing in likeness to Christ? Are you imitating his responses when you're stuck in traffic, when you've lost the keys, when something breaks, when you feel stressed? Do people see you growing more like him as you imitate him? Research by Tom Rainer, compiled in his book, I Am a Church Member, suggests some alarming facts. Listen to these statistics. He said, based on our research, 9 of 10 churches in America are declining or growing at a rate that is slower than that of their communities. He says, we can blame it on the secular culture. We can blame it on the godless politics of our nation. We can even blame it on the churches, the hypocritical members, and the uncaring pastors. But then Rainer challenges, I am proposing that we who are church members need to look in the mirror. Many of us have lost the biblical understanding of what it means to be a part of the body of Christ. And Rainer observes, we join our churches expecting them to serve us, to feed us, to care for us. We don't like the hypocrites in the church, but we fail to see our own hypocrisies. He's right. Many American churches are weak because they have members who have turned the meaning of membership upside down. It's time to get it right. It's time to become disciples who can make disciples. It's time to grow Christ followers instead of expecting someone else to fulfill that command from Christ. And so the process is transforming lives to resemble Christ. And the product will be developed disciples who make disciples. The chair 4 mindset is described in Colossians 1:28. It says, He, Christ, is the one we proclaim, admonishing and teaching everyone with all wisdom, so that we may present everyone fully mature in Christ. We want to help all believers grow up to full maturity in their faith. Our purpose is to make disciples who will make disciples. Our older granddaughter, Winnie, started preschool this week. She's getting to be a big girl. She can feed herself, wear big girl pants, and she is establishing independence as she grows and matures. So I want to show a picture of Winnie on the left. That's her first day of preschool this past week. She was rocking the hair bow with a ponytail, and her younger sister, Hazel, pictured with her, is still learning to feed herself and to get beyond the diapers. But she's still young and dependent on others. But in the church, we have a product in mind, a goal of growing to maturity, of achieving independence. That's the desired outcome. Sometimes some Christians haven't been Christians for 20 years, but they've been Christians for 1 year 20 times. Failing to get beyond the milk and cookies and desire the meat of the word. Others need to learn to feed themselves and grow spiritually. Some need to grow beyond insisting on their preferences and how to do that without fussing and fighting. Just as preschool teaches a child to play fair, growing disciples need to learn to disagree without being disagreeable. As we become more focused on the needs of others and less focused on self, those are signs that we are growing toward maturity. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, the Apostle Paul employs the metaphor of the human body with many members and likens the church to the human body. The church is described as a body composed of many parts that working together are intended to have a singleness of purpose. Would you follow along with me? Verse 14 of 1 Corinthians 12. Even so, the body is not made up of one part, but of many. Now, if the foot should say, because I'm not a hand, I do not belong to the body, it would not for that reason stop being a part of the body. If the ear should say, well, because I'm not an eye, I do not belong to the body, it would not for that reason stop being a part of the body. But we need each of these independent parts working together interdependently. It reminds me of the guy who went to the doctor and wasn't feeling well, and he said, Doc, I'm really concerned. I hurt all over. When I press on my chin, it hurts. When I press my arm, ouch, it hurts. When I press on my leg, ooh, it hurts. Doc, what is wrong with me? It's simple. You have a broken finger. Well, each part of the church body is important, whether you are a finger, an ear, an eye. Although there are many parts, there is a unity when we are fulfilling our purpose. And just as in the human body, that the various parts work together in concert. I hate to do this to you before lunch, but if you eat a hamburger, it involves many functions occurring simultaneously. Your eyes see the food. Your arms reach for the burger. Your hands pick up the burger. Your salivary glands begin to gleat or secrete saliva to begin the process of breaking down the food. Your incisor teeth will tear the meat, while the molars begin to grind the particles of food. The jaws work to chew up the food. The throat begins the swallowing process. The stomach processes and utilizes the nutritional value of the food, while your gastrointestinal tract completes the process of digestion and elimination. You talk about a team effort. That's what God intended for the church body. But we each have some specific gifts or talents to use, but in a general way, we're all commanded to make disciples. That's everybody's job. No one gets a pass on that. We can't hide behind the convenient evasion, "That's not my gift." Some of our members may be more gifted at evangelism, but clearly it remains the duty of every Christ follower to go and bear fruit. Just because that comes easier for another than for you, God has placed you where others will never have the chance to share his love. Proximity matters. You live, exercise, shop, work with some people I'll never meet. Your efforts for eternity can make a definite difference for them. But let me put it this way. If I'm in a restaurant and someone seated near me is choking, I may not be the best trained person to administer the Heimlich maneuver, but because of my proximity at that moment, I am the best person to save that life. And our concern for a lost friend's soul should motivate every one of us to move into chair four and give our best effort to reach a new disciple who will disciple others. It was said of the first Christians that they turned the world upside down, which really means they took an upside down world and turned it right side up, Acts 17:6. That didn't happen because of the soul-winning prowess of Simon Peter or the Apostle Paul. It came because of the collective contribution of all Christians embracing their roles and making an eternal difference in another's life. Speaking of chair four's call to make disciples, author Dan Spader submits the need to evangelize and disciple because both are critical. He says, without evangelism, you cannot develop fully trained disciples, nor will you have any new disciples. And without discipleship, you will not have any equipped disciples to go out and share their faith. Making disciples who can make disciples is the end product of our efforts of reproduction. We measure success by multiplication. End quote. Over Jesus' earthly ministry, he had taken his disciples from seekers to followers to co-workers and then finally disciple makers. He told them to go do what he had done with them, to go and make disciples of all nations. Jesus modeled the process by which we must do that. God often calls a chair four person into a unique ministry situation. A chair four person is no longer content with just leading Bible studies or being involved in church activities. They come to understand the mission of Jesus and the mission given to us. They want to experience him fully, to experience disciple making and building a movement of multiplication. That's what happened in the first century. And we have the opportunity to do that once again. That's our assignment still today. We make a difference by making disciples locally and globally through our ministry efforts. remember Matthew 28, where it says literally, as you are going. So go out and be Jesus to the people you encounter. I heard a podcast this week from Greg Laurie, a minister on the West Coast, and he was at a gas station recently, and he saw a couple who were looking under the car seat cushions, desperately scraping together all their change, any money they could find. And then they went to the counter ahead of him and asked to have $1.27 of gas put on pump two. He thought, wow, these guys are hurting. So outside, they stepped out, and Laurie asked them, may I buy you a tank of gas? In deep need, they immediately agreed. And then Laurie took out a $100 bill and gave it to them, explaining, I want you to have this. God has dramatically changed my life, and I want you to know he loves you, and he cares about your struggles. And the man and woman began to cry and hugged Laurie. And there are people who will not come to us, so we must go to them. Chair 4 people understand that we are Christ's ambassadors to a lost world, 2 Corinthians 5:20. And that everything is about reaching out, serving them, loving unconditionally, earning the right to be heard. Louise Pillow spoke of evangelism as going about loving people until they ask why, and then telling them about Jesus. What would happen if instead of a few people at BCC, all of us caught the rush of being a disciple maker? We would have to add more services to keep up with the multiplication that God would do. And that was Christ's original plan for disciples making disciples. When Disney World first opened, Mrs. Walt Disney was asked to speak at the grand opening since Walt had died. She was introduced by a man who said, Mrs. Disney, I just wish Walt could have seen this. She stood up and said, he did, and sat down. Walt Disney had a vision for what could become in the future. He could see it. Can you see what God is wanting to do to our church and through our church? Can you picture what would happen if each one of us got focused on making disciples who in turn would make disciples? Can you envision a strong, healthy, growing church of disciple makers that resembles the original first century church? A church family that is mobilized and effective in carrying out our mission to love God, love people, impact the world. I can see that. In the moments that remain, you must decide the chair you want to move into today. I'm going to ask you to bow your head and silently answer these following questions as we enter into a time of self-inventory. These are chair 4 questions for each of us to consider. Am I a disciple maker or just a church attender? Am I growing in my walk with the Lord and influencing others for Christ? Do I have the courage to help carry out the Master's marching orders? Each Christian functioning as a healthy member offers something to the body. If you don't fulfill your part, it diminishes what we could accomplish that God has prepared for us to do. Am I sitting in chair 4 as a disciple maker? And if not, why not? Is it because of fear? Is it the lack of preparation? We can provide you with training. Is it because of pride? Is it because of wrong priorities? Who am I currently praying for and trying to lead to the Lord? if I had a role in leading someone to Christ, if I ever baptized anyone, if I've been guilty of substituting attendance or serving for carrying out the Great Commission. In my life, has Christ's final mandate been the Great Commission or the Great Omission? Last question. As a result of this series, what will I do differently? Our goal is multiplication. Never forget, we want to reach new people, chair two, see them grow, equip them as workers, chair three, and then send them out to launch new ministries, chair four. Multiplication is our goal. We want all to go and bear fruit. Would you pray with me? Father, Lord of the harvest, we pray that you would convict us of what we need to do differently going forward, and that we would evaluate in which chair we are sitting and not grow comfortable in that chair, but be willing to move into the next chair, the next assignment you have for us, the next opportunity. And Lord, I pray for a church of disciple makers, that you would raise up many workers who embrace your vision of taking your message to the whole world before your son's return. We pray in his name. Amen. This morning, we're challenging you to honestly evaluate two questions. First, in which chair am I currently sitting? And then the second is, as a result of this series, into which chair am I going to move? Maybe it's from chair one to chair two if you're ready to commit your life fully to Christ and be immersed. As an already immersed believer today, maybe you want to place your membership at Brighton. Move from chair two to chair three, where you're a co-worker serving others and actively pointing others to the Lord. Maybe you're wanting to grow into becoming a chair four disciple, intentionally pouring your influence into others who will in turn influence others and fulfill that Great Commission with the reverberating effect that Jesus intended and designed. As we sing our invitation song, I'm inviting you to move into the next chair. And you can come forward, and our Next Steps team can help you confess Christ and be baptized. Maybe you want to speak to someone about moving to chair three to become a co-worker and begin serving and reaching out here. Perhaps God is challenging you to move from chair three into chair four, directly discipling people who will become disciple makers themselves. We'll help you figure it out. Don't delay. Respond today. Would you come to the front as we stand and as we sing? Thank you.
We're working on life groups not to be short term, not to be 6-week studies, but to go along with the school year. And we really need more life group leaders. So if you're a member here, if you're a husband and wife team, you want to teach, you want to help in any way, then I'm going to step outside in the lobby. I'll put a mask on, but you come out and you see me or send me an email. We'd love to have you serve in that way. Join a life group. There are life group signups out at the coffee bar. It's not being used for coffee, but it can be used for community. So sign up today so that we can do life together in community with life groups. I'm really excited about the life group study. I'm going to be teaching our life group leaders from noon to 2 today. So please be praying over that time that we have together. It's a very special time here at Bright Christian Church. Last thing I want to share is that throughout this series, one of the things I've been considering is having a class that walks people through the process of salvation. And maybe you say, I did that years ago. Someone walked me through the process of salvation. I surrendered my life to the Lord. Well, maybe you could use that tool to walk someone else through. I love teaching that tool so that someone else can use the tool to lead someone else to Christ. So if you want more confidence in walking someone through the process of salvation, or you're someone who's considering surrendering your life, look for information coming out tomorrow. We'll send it out by email. So that's really important you drop that connection card if we don't have your email address and that's something that you're considering. Look for information to come out. Let's pray together before we leave. And as we go, let's impact the world. Father, this morning we give you praise. We are so grateful that you have given us this time together early in the week to start our week together in community and in communion with you, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. We don't take this time lightly. We thank you that you've taught us this morning from your unchanging printed page of truth. God, thank you for teaching us. As we've encountered you this morning, would you change us, transform us, and use us this week as we go about our lives so that we can reach people for the Lordship of Jesus Christ. God, we give you our week, and we thank you for our lives. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. God bless you. Have a great week.